What is a saint? That is the question. At least it's the question we'll be wrestling with over the next few weeks as we approach All Saints Sunday. So what is a saint? Anyone at all? How would you define it? Help me out. Carl?
Believer in Christ.
A believer in Christ. Okay. Anyone else? Believer in Christ. Okay. Others? What is the saint?
A believer and doer in Christ.
A believer and doer in Christ. I like that. Wonderful definitions of a saint. The dictionary would define a saint as something like this: a certain person of exceptional holiness of life, or a person of great holiness, virtue, and benevolence. Our word saint comes from the Latin term sanctus, and it means something like to be put apart, to be sanctified. It means to be made holy. In Greek, the word is mentioned some 230 times. It's angelos, and it's often simply translated as holy. But sometimes it's used as an adjective, and when it's used as an adjective, particularly of people, the word is often translated as saints. And so, technically speaking, saints are those holy ones, if you will. Those holy people. But definitions only go so far, don't they? Because we humans think in terms of pictures. So just close your eyes for a moment or two, or just go in your mind's eye, and what do you see when you hear the word saint or saints? Open your eyes. I want to suggest that you see something like these, or at least many people do. Okay, can I get the ushers to come forward? Hopefully this is enough to cover, and maybe there are extras up here. So if you hand out one of these to each and every person. This is a halo. In fact, if traditionally, you know, many pictures of the saints are drawn with halos. Cheryl? There's something like that, right? Almost universally, saints have a halo. And did you know it was a common practice not only in Christian circles, but throughout much of the ancient... Bob, you're really cute with that halo. It was common practice in much of the ancient world to dignify those important mentors or heroes with a halo. It's in fact found not only in Christian circles, but in the pagan world. It's found as far as China. The thought is that someone of great notoriety or dignity has a glow of God about them, right? And it's often, there are flames that come out behind. Often in Christian art, the halo has a cross. Have you seen that before? But the thought is that a saint is someone that has the glow of God, has the luster of God's holiness, and it just glows through them. And it's no wonder, because Christians, like many others, we have this way of looking for mentors, don't we? We often want heroes. And so as Christians gained in power, and they started drawing some of the heroes of their faith, they naturally turned and started drawing the heroes of the faith with what? With a halo, signifying that they had the glow of God. And in Roman Catholicism, many of us know that they took this and have taken it to an extreme, haven't they? They actually have a whole set of principles and rules to determine who a saint is. How many are aware of that? There are five steps in order for somebody to be recognized as worthy of sainthood. Those steps are pretty incredible when you think about them. It's called the five steps of saint canonization. First, you have to be recommended by a local bishop. So, if you are recommended to the Vatican's Congregation for the Cause of Saints, that's the first step. Now, that Congregation for the Cause of Saints, then the second step is they have to accept you. And once they accept you, then they begin a process of evaluating whether you're worthy to be a saint. In other words, they say you have to have lived a heroically virtuous life. There we go. And if you've lived a heroically virtuous life, you can be approved by this congregation. And then you're sent to three others to be evaluated. You're sent to the Pope, a leading theologian, and then a doctor, an independent doctor. And they have to determine whether posthumously, after your death, a miracle has been performed in your name. And that miracle has to be instantaneous, permanent, complete, and scientifically unexplainable. So if that theologian, and if that doctor, and the Pope agree that that's what occurred in your name, an instantaneous, permanent, complete, and scientifically unexplainable miracle, then you get passed on to the fifth step by the Pope. And that fifth step just repeats step four. So you have to find a second posthumous miracle performed in the name that is verified as what? Instantaneous, permanent, complete, and scientifically unexplainable. And if that has occurred in your name, and the Pope is sure that you have universal church appeal, then guess what? You get the halo. Now, I know you didn't come here for a lesson in Catholicism. And I'm not trying to convert you because I have a lot of problems with that whole process, okay? I am a Protestant and I am proud of it. But I bring it to our attention because it displays how we often think of saints. We often think of them as we define them. That they are individuals of great holiness, virtue, or benevolence. They are exceptional holiness. They are extraordinary. They are incomparable. They're like those holy folks, those folks who are set apart, who are different from common believers like you and me. They just kind of float through life. They're individuals that glow and radiate. They have a halo almost over them. And they are morally and spiritually on another plane. That's how we often view saints, isn't it? We often look at saints like we do the passage from Ephesians. And we read it kind of as a criteria of what it means to be a saint. I mean, after all, Paul, writing to these early Christians, he says, saints there. So we go, okay, Paul, now you're going to tell us what a saint is. Well, a saint is somebody who stays away from fornication. That's any sort of sexual impropriety, any sort of sexual activity outside the bounds of marriage. That's what it means in the Greek. Saints are those who have no impurity of any kind, right? No greed. These things shouldn't even be mentioned among the saints. They walk around in thanksgiving, praising the Lord. Paul continues. They don't associate, right? They're set apart. They don't associate with those who are of the world, that are different and do those sorts of things. Paul continues in verse 11, they take no part in unfruitful works of darkness, but instead they expose them, right? And once again, he says, they don't even mention these unfruitful and seedy things that are happening in the world around them. And Paul continues, they walk as wise people, right? And they make the most of their time. They don't fritter away any of their time. Everything is dedicated to the things of God. And they're not foolish, Paul continues. And they don't, certainly don't get drunk with wine, right? But they're drunk on the Spirit. And Paul says they're not about debauchery, but they sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among themselves. And they're giving thanks to God at all times. And I don't know about you, but a couple of thoughts come to my mind as I read that passage, especially with the thought that this is a definition of sainthood. The first thing, your pastor's a little strange, okay? But I get some of these strange views in my mind. But when I read this about the songs and singing to one another, I think it's like one of those Hollywood musicals. You know, everything's perfect. Everybody's walking around smiling. And Christians are greeting one another and singing song. Well, hello, Peter. So good to see you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, Bob, my brother, saying, good to see you. I get that kind of image. Or the other thought I get in my mind is like, holy baloney. If that's what it means to be a saint, I ain't gonna make it. I'm not gonna make it. In fact, I'm not sure anyone makes it. Any of us fulfill that at all times? Any of us fulfill that at all times? And I go, maybe being a saint is simply impossible. Maybe the Catholics are right after all. Uh-oh. We're in trouble, aren't we, Protestants? This morning I want to suggest a different way to start looking at sainthood. Instead of using human definitions and human traditions to define what a saint is, maybe you and I are called to go back to the Bible. What does the Bible really say about what a saint is? Or saint? One of the best passages, go to the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews. If you have your Bibles, go to the 11th chapter. Matter of fact, here's a homework assignment. Before next week, read through the 11th chapter of Hebrews with an eye to what it means to be a saint, because he's talking about the great people of faith. And so I'm not going to bore you or insult your intelligence by reading it to you, but I just point out some of the models or examples of faithfulness that the author of Hebrews brings. He talks about Abel. Okay, we got that, right? Abel, yeah, Cain, you know, all that. Yeah, Abel was good. Then he talks about Enoch. Remember, Enoch was so holy, he was just swept up. He never faced death. Okay, got that. That's really good. And then all of a sudden he talks about Noah. Oh. What about that debauchery thing? Didn't Noah go on a drunken stupor after? Yeah. Wow. And then Abraham. Remember Abraham? Taking an additional wife? Lying? Wow. Abraham. And then Sarah. He talks about, wow, Sarah who laughed at God and the angels? Wow. And Isaac, well, you have some sympathy for Isaac, but Jacob? That scoundrel Jacob is listed here? Wow, and then we could continue on and cite others. He talks about Abraham. How about Joseph? Well, Joseph was pretty good, but he might have had a little ego, right? To his brothers, look at me, what daddy has given me. And then Moses, what was Moses? Didn't he murder someone? Wow, he was a murderer. Well, there's Moses. And then we continue verse 32. He talks about Gideon. Go and read your Bible about Gideon. Gideon's in a wine vat when God wants him to do something. Gideon's a coward. And there's humor there because the angel comes and says to Gideon, O thou great warrior, and he's hiding in a wine vat. And then how about Barak? I mean, I mean, there he is. He was on the coattails of Deborah, the prophet. In fact, he wouldn't do what God wanted him to do unless Deborah came with him. Women, you know, some men maybe are like that a little bit. And then we get Samson. Wow. What modern sin does Samson not embrace if you read about his life, huh? And Jephthah. Remember Jephthah, the great prophet? Who said as he entered the town of God, if you give me this, I'll give whatever comes out of my door to you as a sacrifice. And his daughter ran out. Wow. Wow. As I read this, I find a little more hope, don't you? I find a little bit of more hope. In fact, one commentator reading through this said these words. He said, saints become saints by somehow clinging to the stubborn conviction that God deserves our trust, even when it looks as if the world is caving in. Saints aren't faultless, they're forgiven. They're not perfect, but they're persistent. They are not flawless, they are faithful. As one author puts it, the wonderful thing about saints is that they were human. They lost their tempers, got hungry, scolded God, were egotistical or testy or impatient in their turns, made mistakes and regretted them, still they went on doggedly blundering toward heaven. I like that. I can doggedly blunder towards heaven. How about you? Maybe you and I need to think of saints in a different light. There's an old humorous story that a seeker was going to a saint to get the wisdom that the saint had learned over his lifetime. And so you can see this seeker on a voyage, climbing the mountains into the wilderness, and finally came into the presence of the seeker. In the presence of the saint, and the seeker said these words. He said, please tell me, O wise one, O great saint, how did you become holy? Two words. The saint replied. And what are they? Please tell me. Right choices, said the saint. And how does one choose correctly? The seeker replied. One word. Well, may I please know that one word? Growth. How does one grow, O wise one, O saint? Two words. Oh, please tell me those two words. Please tell me. Wrong choices. Wrong choices. What is a saint? That is the question. A saint is probably not who we think a saint is. So come on back next week and we're going to talk a little bit more about what a saint is. Yes. Okay. Back next week if you're in town, because we're going to talk about at least Mother Teresa. So, we're not done talking about sainthood, so please, there's a halo deposit in the back of the church. So as you depart, please deposit your halos, because we haven't reached what a saint truly is yet, okay? If you take your halo home, that's fine. We're not going to send the United Methodist men after you. Okay, it's all good. Carl, if you want to walk around all next week with your halo on, that's fine.
I'm wearing one if you don't see.
But come on back. Invite a friend. We're going to talk a little bit more about what it means to be a saint. And between now and then, read through chapter 11 of Hebrews. And ask yourself, what is really a saint? And ask yourself this poignant question. Can I be a saint? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.